Hello everyone and welcome. This is the Apostate Prophet. Who else could it be? The Apostate Prophet. Can you imagine me being an actual prophet? I don't go to caves by myself for some reason, listen to voices, tell my wife about those voices in my head, then go out and tell everyone that I'm a prophet because my filthy rich wife told me so. But imagine I'm a prophet, and I tell you that I bring you the message of an almighty God who delivers his message through a mindless angel to me. After declaring my prophethood, a friend is very supportive of me and believes me very much. But this friend is also very annoying and tells me all the time that I should order my children to wear sunglasses because that way they appear cooler. I think that's a very stupid idea, so I ignore him all the time. Why would I tell my children to wear sunglasses? And finally, this friend of mine sees my children one day without sunglasses and says to them, "I see your eyes." So my kids come to me and tell me about it, and finally I think, come on, why do I have such a moronic friend? But the next day, I go out and declare that God said, "Tell the believing children to wear sunglasses, at least at school. This is better for them and makes them appear really cool. Indeed, God favors cool-looking boys. God is most merciful, most cool, most moist." And after this glorious revelation from God is revealed, my friend is happy until eternity and goes around bragging about how the Almighty, the most merciful, the most cool, the most humid, God agrees with him, an annoying fat guy who can't mind his own business. At that point, you would probably think that the message that I bring, which is from the Almighty God, is not really from the Almighty God, right? And that is about what happened 1,400 years ago in a land far away, in the middle of a desert, in a tiny city known as Medina. The origin of the hijab, the obligatory veiling of all women. Many Muslims don't even know about this. I didn't know either, and are usually very surprised once they learn about it. If you search for this topic online, you can't find much from proper Islamic sources either, beside forums and blog posts that rationalize and engage in weak apologetics. Therefore, I will gladly inform everyone, especially every Muslim, about the origins of the hijab. Mohammed was a little merchant in Arabia. He had a rich wife who supported his prophethood and funded it. At some time, Mohammed moved from Mecca to Medina, where he gained a lot of followers. By then, Umar, a pretty impulsive guy who loved strict rules and wanted to kill Mohammed in the past, had converted to Islam and was now one of Mohammed's close advisors. He would also become the second caliph in the future and rule over all Muslims. Mohammed loved flattering Umar. We see this in multiple hadiths where Mohammed praises Umar and even says that if there were to be a prophet after himself, it would be Umar. There are many hadiths in which Umar tells people, including Mohammed, what to do. But let's not even get into that and distract much from the topic. This topic is very important. Umar had some very special interest in the wives of Muhammad, of which Muhammad had many. So much that according to multiple Islamically reliable and authentic narrations, Umar told Muhammad very often to order his wives to veil themselves. But Muhammad simply ignored his request. It's important to know that the hijab was not a fundamental practice in the beginning. It became part of Islam later, still during Muhammad's life. Many things in Islam happened this way, including the ban on alcohol or the five daily prayers. Now, according to at least four hadiths narrated by Aisha, Muhammad's child bride, one day one of Muhammad's wives, Sauda, left her house at night to go to answer the call of nature. That refers to going to the toilet. And when Umar saw her outside, he acted like a creep. Let's read the hadith, narrated by Aisha. The wives of the Prophet used to go to Al-Manasi, a vast open place, to answer the call of nature at night. Umar used to say to the Prophet, "Let your wives be veiled," but Allah's Apostle did not do so. One night, Sauda bin Zamah, the wife of the Prophet, went out at Isha time, which is the last prayer time, at night, and she was a tall lady. Umar addressed her and said, "I have recognized you, O Sauda." I have recognized you, O Sauda. He said so, as he desired eagerly that the verses of Al-Hijab, the observing of veils by the Muslim women, may be revealed. So Allah revealed the verses of Al-Hijab, a complete body cover, excluding the eyes. Okay, a few things. Why is Umar telling Mohammed what to do with his wives? Why is Umar telling Mohammed, the holy chosen prophet, what rules to install? Why is Umar acting like a creep? But most importantly, why is Umar, a mere human, interfering in human interactions in order to trigger a divine revelation from Allah? Isn't Allah Almighty and All-Knowing and has a plan from the beginning? According to Islamic belief, the Quran was also complete long before it was revealed, long before the creation of humankind. How come Allah makes such a rule after Umar asks Muhammad multiple times for such a rule and triggers it lastly by making a creepy approach to Muhammad's wife? I'm not making this up. These are all completely reliable, Islamically reliable narrations. If this is what happened, and according to Islamic sources, this is what happened, then how can anyone believe Muhammad to be a true messenger of an almighty Allah who makes the rules for all humankind? Why does Umar's behavior, his creepy insistence, and Muhammad's despair lead to a general and strict rule of veiling all women for over 1,400 years so far? That's not all. Umar's words in the future make the whole situation even more bizarre. Umar said reportedly that Allah, the Almighty One, agreed with him on three things, including the hijab. So Umar came up with an idea, and the Almighty God passed the law. In one hadith, we even see that Umar gave Allah more ideas. One day, Umar entered Muhammad's house and said to Muhammad's wives, "Stop troubling the Prophet, or Allah will give him better wives than you." Can you guess what happened next? Allah suddenly revealed a Quran verse through Muhammad. Perhaps his Lord, if he divorced you all, would substitute for him wives better than you, submitting to Allah, believing, devoutly obedient, repentant, worshipping, and fast, previously married and virgins. Aside from the fact that this Quran verse sounds very much like, "Hey, you are only women, behave yourselves," this is also coincidentally exactly what Umar said according to a hadith. I don't know. To me, it looks like Muhammad and Umar worked very well together, and Umar knew that Muhammad is making all of this up. And he saw the perfect chance in fabricating things together with Muhammad and ruling over people, because it had worked well so far. Of course, you could also say that Umar was just a wonderful person, a true believer, and that Allah granted him such holiness, and that's why he foretold Allah's steps. That would be a good excuse to hold on to Islam, although you know that there is something wrong with it. No, instead, everyone should look at these narrations, be totally honest, and really question how this religion has been taken seriously, how anyone could take it seriously today. It's clear to me, there is nothing supernatural, nothing divine about it. Just simple people pretending to be holy, commanding people around, trying to fool them and be successful at it. Well, then again, if you set a condition of staying within the faith once you join, and dying if you leave, you don't have to be very successful at that. Anyway, according to narrations, there are at least two more things that Umar suggested that became divine orders afterward. But let's just end this with a very perfectly befitting related narration instead. Narrated by Aisha. Sauda went out to answer the call of nature after it was made obligatory to observe the veil. Umar saw her and said, "O Sauda, by Allah, you cannot hide yourself from us. So think of a way by which you should not be recognized on going out." Sauda returned while Allah's apostle was in my house, Aisha's house, taking his supper, and a bone covered with meat was in his hand. She entered and said, "O Allah's apostle, I went out to answer the call of nature, and Umar said to me so and so." Then Allah inspired the prophet, and when the state of inspiration was over and the bone was still in his hand as he had not put it down, he said to Sauda, "You women have been allowed to go out for your needs." Muhammad receives revelations in a state of trance and makes just another revelation. That just reminds me of something pretty odd and Turkish, or just Turkish, that I have seen in the past. A self-proclaimed prophet and Islamic scholar receiving divine inspiration during a live talk.
Efendimiz, bana lütfen cevap verebilir misiniz? Tabiyetim kabul olmuş mu diye? Bilmiyoruz. Evet evladım, tabiyetin kabul olmuş. Şimdi zikirlerine namaz da ilave etmelisin ve bana da rapor vermelisin.
I don't see any difference here. Don't fall for 7th century desert magic. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, don't forget to like, to subscribe, and to share. If you want to support our cause of exposing Islam for what it is and informing people, you can support me on Patreon or PayPal. The links are below in the description. Thank you very much for every kind of support. I'll be back again next week. Have a great weekend, and please, stay away from Islam.